some of you say, well, Brother Wood, I really don't believe that. God's my witness tonight. I've tried to get out of this all day. But this is what the Lord wants. And back in 1946, when the war was over, there was a meeting with a bunch of men and John Mackay, who was the president or head man at Princeton University, was a liberal, theologian, and he brought it up that they needed to get one man, and that one man was to evangelize America. And then right after they made that motion, they called Dr. Bob Jones out to preach, senior, the old man who's dead now. And he got up and preached, and these people had a plan. And the plan was, the war is over, and we want to fill these churches. They called them churches, the Methodists and Baptists and Episcopalians and what have you. They said, we want to fill these churches, and we want to get one man, and use one man, and all the churches go together and fill our churches. And Dr. Bob Jones got up, Bob Jones Sr., in 1946, and said, if you do that, you'll kill the churches. You'll kill evangelism. Evangelism is for the local churches. And so the old man, he done his job and done it well, and they voted that down. But there was a plan, and I call it the plan of conspiracy, and that conspiracy was to put in the hands of one man the job of evangelizing America. Now, the purpose of this conspiracy was to fill the churches. Fill the churches. And that's never been God's plan. God is to get people saved, born again. And that was the purpose. And the power that they were to use was money, the media, the masses, and the ministry. Now, I want you to get that. They had to have the money, they got that, rich men. Media, they got that. Religion has use of all media. Then they had the masses and the ministry. Now, the principle that was laid out was this. When every time an old outlaw, dope fiend, or gangster gets saved, then we'll get him up immediately and give his testimony, because people will come to hear him, they won't come to hear a preacher. And so they begin to use those men. That's the first time if that was ever used, whores like Jane Russell girls like that, they were asked to come to the platform, get up in the pulpit, and give their testimony. Now, when do you ever believe that a man of God would let a dirty-legged prostitute like that get in the pulpit? Yeah. Amen? Yeah. Amen. And so this was the principle that was laid out. And so they said, let's forget doctrine, advocate love, and do away with words like repentance, born again, and hell. And so they did. Now, the paralyzing effect of this thing, it was carried out in 1949, voted in, and they began to look for that man that they would use. And this conspiracy was carried completely through until our day. It corrupted our schools. It corrupted our Bibles. It corrupted the man of God. It corrupted our nation and got outside and corrupted the world. That's a great conspiracy. And I'm telling you, this conspiracy was started in 1946 in the World Council of Churches and carried out, and buddy, they've done a good job. I want to commend them. They've done a good job. Yeah. I was a member of the Southern Baptist, and I remember Dr. Otis Strickland, that great man there in Texas. He got up and said, we'll have no part of this, no part of this. But they never heard his voice. He was fired from the school, and it was carried out in our state, and so they began to look for that evangelist. Well, 1937, Dr. Monroe Parker was holding a little meeting down here in Charlotte, and a young man named Billy Graham, he was staying in his father's home, Frank Graham, and Billy Graham made a profession of faith in his meeting. Said he got saved. Well, he sent him off to Bob Jones, and a bunch of things transpired. But a few years later, he heard him give his testimony. He said he got saved under Mordecai Ham. And so he asked him, he said, Billy, I don't want to, Dr. Monroe Parker, if he's here tonight, I'd tell it. I knew James Parker was a friend of mine, pastor right there by me, who's his brother. I knew him. He was a Southern Baptist man. But those Parker boys, it was all good men. But he said, Billy, there's been a misunderstanding. He said, you know, you come forward, accepted Christ, was baptized in the meeting when I was out, and I told a lot of people that you were saved in my meeting. And I just asked him, oh, well, you saved? He said, well, I had made a profession in Mordecai Ham's meeting in Charlotte,
And he said, and then after that, I got to drinking and everything and running around for about a year. And then you come to town and preach, and I made another profession, and I made another profession. So, and really, it doesn't make you know why I was saved. The thing is, I've been saved. And he said, well, you know, I just want to get it clear. Well, Brother Jack Woods don't believe he ever got saved. I don't believe man's ever saved. I believe that history has taught me that, that he's not saved. So you say, well, I differ with you. Okay, that's your opinion. I just gave you mine. So you, that's your opinion. You got a right to that. Don't you? We're Americans. Some of us fought in the war for it. And so you can have your opinion. I have mine. But I would like you to hear the facts that I base my opinion on. And then if you want to write down some facts and say, well, brother, this is why I believe what I believe, then you write them down and I will read them, and we won't be any argument about them. So the first thing I'd like you to look at is your Bible tonight in John 17 and chapter 4, if you have your Bible. 17, verse 14. Excuse me. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them. Now, I know you're here with me in John 17:14. I'm sorry tonight. I make no apology. I've done what God told me to do. I've never preached this message before, but I'm fixing to preach it now. I've taught it to my church in Sunday school. This is Sunday school material for us. And if you can't chew it, well, maybe you ought to go to Sunday school. Amen? Yeah. I give it to my people in Sunday school. Amen? But I've given them thy word, and the world has hated them. How come you done made up your mind and you ain't never heard me yet? How come you made up your mind and you haven't heard me yet? I have given them thy word, the world has hated them, because they're not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Now, Jesus said, I give them the word, the world hates it. Now, I would like to say the first thing, the reason, my reasoning, and it's my reasoning. It's my reasoning, and I'm telling you tonight, not a theological thing, I'm giving you my reason. And Jack Wood's reason says that Billy Graham is accepted by the world. If you're not saved here tonight, if you're not saved, you're mad already. And if somebody would come up and say, come to your house tomorrow and say, where was you at? Well, I found old Carl Lassie's church. Well, I don't even believe he's a Christian old heathen. And you say, well, I don't know if he's not. But tonight, I tell you, Billy Graham's going to say, you're mad. How come your ears already red? Isn't that strange? Your ears already got red. But now, he is accepted by the world. Now, you prove that, Brother Wood. Well, he has all of the... He can preach on any radio and any television in America. Yeah. Yes, you and I can't. Amen? Right. Yeah. He's carried by the media. The media accepts him, condones him, and congratulates him for everything he says. Right. And that's right. They didn't do nothing to us that way. Huh? Amen? Amen. All right. All right. So he's accepted by the world. The newspapers, they write everything he says. And the newspaper now there write everything they find bad about Carl Lassie. Houston says everything bad they can say about Jack Wood. I can send you some news clippings on me that you would probably leave. That's right. All right. But the news media, the world, loves Dr. Graham. The newspaper loved Dr. Graham. The, what would we call them, politicians? They want his approval. Yes, yes. Amen? And he's got theirs. Now, you listen to me. The religionist, you go any modernistic church here in town that don't believe nothing, and you walk in and say, what do you think about Dr. Graham? I believe that he's one of the most wonderful Christians that there are. What do you think about Carl Lackey? They say, yeah. Amen? Yeah. You might want to be fair with me. Hear me out. Hear me out. I've got my ideas about this thing. He's invited to Washington. Amen? He's invited to all of the large conferences of the world. He's invited to foreign countries. I mean, the communists call him friend. Everybody in the world tonight, he's their friend. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. The Bible says the world speaks good of you. Woo-hoo. Amen? He said, I've given them thy word. And the world has hated them because they're not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. Now, look at verse 16. They're not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. then why does the world love this man? Now, I believe, I've always believed, for 25 years I've taught it, you flip it over in your mind two or three times, I believe that the devil in every country of the world has him a seat. And the Bible says that that's where Satan's seat is. And Satan sits up in a stronghold to ruin that nation. I believe with all my heart that the devil owns the country of Paris, France. I believe Paris is a place where he draws up the fashion for women to dress. In the city of Rome, he owns Rome. That's where she is. And that's where he designs all of his rotten religion. But I'm going to tell you one thing that many years ago God showed me, that the devil owns Los Angeles, California. And he's used that one city of more than any other city in the world to corrupt the whole world. He's used the movies and the Marilyn Monroe's, and he has rotted our nation to the core. And in 1951, this young evangelist goes there and had a 3-week meeting, and nothing happened until an old drunk walked down the aisle and they said, we're going to have this Stuart Hamlin to come and sing. And when Stuart Hamlin sang that night, and the tent was filled because of Stuart Hamlin, not because of Billy Graham. Don't need no amen. You don't need to say amen to me. I already believe this anyway. He's accepted by the world. Jesus said, amen. If any man is a friend of the world, he's an enemy of God. I believe I'll just say what Jesus said. Here a few years ago, over there in Japan, they said, Dr. Graham, what do you think about the Shinto religion? He said, I believe the Shinto religion on national television in Japan. He said, I believe that us Christians have a lot to learn from the Shintos. What do you think about the Hindus? Same thing, same story. What did Jesus say? He had said, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no man comes to the Father but by me. So he's accepted by the world. And he has the approval of all wicked religion. And you write that down. You write that down in front of your Bible. And all religion says, did you hear what they did at that King James Jubilee? A man got up and said that Billy Graham was not a Christian. And on the same news, they cussed over this church, they cussed the pastor, and they said, what do you think about that? And they said, that's probably so. But I want to tell you something tonight. Dr. Billy Graham has the approval of every rotten religion in the world today. The other day he started to ride to Russia. When he was going to Russia over there, as he was going through there, he stopped by Rome. He stopped by Rome and he asked the Pope. He said, my dear Christian brother, what do you think we ought to do? I'm going to tell you something now, you think it might be funny. But I've got a picture when two Catholic priests hung the yoke of Rome upon him. And he said, this is one of, Leroy, you've seen it. He said, this is the most wonderful hour in my life, as he put that black yoke upon his neck. He's yoked up with Rome. And he has the approval of all religion. Every modernist Methodist thinks he's the greatest man in the world. Every modernist Presbyterian thinks he's the greatest thing in the world. And some of you fundamental Baptists do too. This thing used to not even be an issue, but it rose again. And just what we came out of 25 years ago, we're headed straight back to what we come out of. Yes, sir. Us fundamental Bible-believing Baptists are listening to some men that are leading us astray, and they're not fundamentalists. They do not believe this Bible is the Word of God. And I'm just here to tell you, most of them don't even know what salvation is. I'll get through here in a minute. Don't you jump out. Dr. Shaffin in my city is the coordinator of the Billy Graham Crusade. He's the coordinator. He had a front page. He's a Southern Baptist pastor in our city, the biggest church there. He had a front page, and he said, is there a devil? He said, there is no such thing as a person of the devil. There is no such a being as the devil. The devil is an influence. How could you be an influence if you wasn't nobody? Dr. Billy Graham, Buddha, Rome, Mohammedism, whatever you say, has no controversy with Dr. Graham. Thank you, Brother Wood. He bears the yoke. Now, the next thing I want you to know, he is opposed by every old warrior of the cross. Old Dr. Bob Jones, if you call him back from the grave tonight, I can see him right now. In 1958 or 9, we had him in a meeting, and he put his hand to his mouth and said, "Boys, come out! Come out!" That rotten thing. Some men came out, and some men stayed in. Like Dr. Paul Carr, and like Evangelist Freddie Gage, and them little old Saturday night evangelists, they all stayed in. They had two-tone shoes, two-tone wives, two-tone cars, and two-tone messages to fit any place they went. Amen. Thank you, Brother Ed. And he is opposed by every John L. Rice and E.Y. Bynum, and read the writing despising. Every man of God stood against it. Why, John Bunyan was put in a prison for what this man has done. This man refused to be approved by the religious order of his day. He was put in prison, laid down 14 years. And I'm saying tonight that this type of minister is a condemnation to those that have lived godly in Christ Jesus. Our forefathers who were Baptists that believed the word of God, they gave their lives for what we're doing here tonight. And I tell you one thing, I refuse to let a man who don't even go to church tell me how to live for God. Remember the First Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas? You called Dr. Crystal tonight and asked him when's the last time he attended. That was about 5 years ago. And if you ain't attended church in about 5 years, I don't think you're much of a Christian. Well, you say, Brother, he's very busy. Okay, we'll just take Brother Jim Wright, for instance. But Jim, you're a very busy man. And so your wife goes and joins the Modernist Presbyterian Church. She takes her children out, lets them dance. And Jim, you just don't have time to go to church. So you're holding 3 big campaigns a year, a week at a time. I mean, that's 3 weeks out of the year. And the rest 49 weeks, you got to rest, man, because you're busy. You're busy. And who in the world would call Jim White for a revival meeting? Now, some of you are mad, but you'll get mad before it's all over. And you'll go outside and you'll argue and argue, but you don't know nothing. You're just dumb, that's all. You have never read that. You ain't never studied that. You don't know what I'm talking about. I'm telling you that a conspiracy was formed in the heart of John Mackay and then that Dr. Fontenay. And those men picked this man out and said, this little fanatic can be groomed, and took him in a bath closet and said, put that word away, that word saved. Born again, repent us and hell out of your invitation. And just say, come down and make a decision and a commitment. And a man who used to say, come and get saved, said, come now and make your decision. And that big smart John Templeton, who was a liberal, he said, y'all just leave this fanatic alone. When I get through grooming him, the church will glean from all the work that he's been doing. The church. That bunch of Episcopalian, a bunch of lost Methodists, ain't none of the church. They're a member of that heart. And they're all going back to Rome. And I've been teaching 25 years that there's a little man named Graham that's leading them home. And they're all headed back to that city on sand hills. You say, I don't believe that. You don't believe nothing. That's all right. I don't bother me a bit in the world. Don't do me a bit in the world. And Carl Lassie's going to preach, I'm going to preach. He's opposed by the old warrior of the cross. And he's a man of great wealth. Owns that, I believe it's called a Raffle, a Rayco jewelry. Owns it last year. It was worth $17 million. You said, brother, well, that's, he put $22 million in this state right here in land. He goes, well, you say, how do you know that? I'm not giving you no secondhand information. I don't put out secondhand information. I either preach the Bible or some facts that I have at hand. I said he owned $22 million worth of this land right here in this state. He's a rich man. Following a man who never had a place to lay his head. How about that? Yeah. Now you say, oh, Carl, he's got a Cadillac. Yeah, and your little pet preacher has got millions stashed away in the bank, you idiot. And you send him some more to put in there. Yeah. But see, he got that from his mama. He was raised to Southern Baptist in up there in Virginia. He found out that they had millions in the mission fund. Back there when I pulled out in 60, they had some 17 million in the mission fund. And he said, if they can have a fund, I can have a fund. And so everybody now has got a fund. Guys like old Bobby Prindle, taking a $20 offering, a $50 offering, going on down the road doing work for God. And you say, you don't have any right. Brother Woods, you don't have right. Okay, we're going to just use Jim. We're going to say Jim's a young preacher and Brother Woods an old preacher. And you, Jim, you say, now, Brother Woods, you don't have any right to criticize that man. He's won more souls than you have. Well, I've won more than you have. You don't have the right to criticize me.
Yeah,
yes, sir. Your mule won't work. Your mule won't work. Amen. So he's a man of great wealth. He has prosperity, he has property, he has popularity, he has millions in the jewel business. Yes, that's his business. No, I'm making it my business. Right here tonight. That's right. Now, I want you to write down the fifth thing. He's never had a severe whipping from God. I believe I'm in a fundamentalist camp tonight. I believe that we're in a King James Jubilee. Brother Wildcard, you've been preaching for many years. What if you would go down there tonight and go over to the First Methodist Church and say, now, First Methodist Church and First Presbyterian Church, and y'all don't believe anything, but let's just get together, and from now on, let's just have a united service, and us three is going to go together. What would be the next thing that you would be looking for God to do to Brother Wise Heart?
Dust his riches.
Knock him in the head.
Yeah.
Drag him off. And bury him somewhere. No man is going to take God's people astray without getting a severe whipping from God. I feel all the resistance. Don't bother me a bit in the world. I preach in jails and prisons where people are just like you. Don't believe nothing. They get up and thank God when they're in jail. They can't walk out because they're in there locked up. Amen? But he never had a severe whipping from God. He's never preached against sin. He's never preached against the modern dance. He's never preached against alcohol. Hey, he said, my Savior, drink it. Yes, sir. I cut it out, paste it in my Bible. If you walk up here tonight, my old godly daddy's been a preacher for all these years. He said, I saw your daddy, Brother Wood, he's drinking some wine. I'd hit you right between the eyeballs. Billy Graham has no right to talk about my Lord. He saved old Jack Wood from a life of sin. He don't have that right. And I'm saying tonight that this man has never had a whipping for God. He's never preached against sin. He's never, never, never denounced rotten religion. You stand to your feet tonight and tell me that you heard him preach against the sins of the Methodists, or the sins of the Presbyterians, or the sins of the Baptists. You say, well, Brother Wood, what he does, he just preaches the word. You moron, you. The Bible said, preach that whole counsel of God.
Yes.
Timothy, preach the word, and be instant in season, out of season, rebuke with all long suffering. A man who's an evangelist of God is to stand and denounce sin.
Right.
But, Brother Witch, you don't understand. The reason he don't is where he can get them all. I know why he don't, honey. You don't have to tell me. See, I've laid awake at night and worried over this thing. I've laid awake at night. Little man Bulgaria here just a year ago. He stood in a Catholic church and preached to 2,200 people. And he said, this is the hour that I've lived for. Is to see Baptist and the Catholic. And all these wonderful Christians meet here together. And I know a man and woman that was locked in a prison just about a mile from there for 14 years because they'd handed out gospel tracts. I tell you what you do, let's walk over tonight and knock on the cell. Hey, brother, if you and your wife, hey, I'd like to get a testimony from you. Brother, you've been here in the prison. You heard about the big meeting downtown? And she had laughed, and he said, it ain't our kind, Brother Wood. Then I said, oh, that was a great evangelistic meeting. He said, Brother Wood, every one of them is KGB men. They're police, Brother Wood. Them's not God's men. God's men are on the ground, Brother Wood. God's men, Brother Wood's hiding out in the woods. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Well, I wish I had another message tonight. You could have probably shouted, but that's not what you really need. He speaks well of all religion. All religion.
Mr. Peel, would you come, please, and lead us in prayer? And old Norman Vincent Peel and two or three more that needs to be peeled, they walk up there and say, "Our dear Heavenly Father." Norman Vincent Peel is a total liberal. Total liberal. I could stop out here and punch it once, but I won't. I'll pass on. He's a total liberal. One of your men not far from here had a wedding in his church with him and helped him marry one of his members. But I won't deal with Jerry Knight. I'm talking about Billy. Amen? He's influenced. He's as a man of whipping. Amen? He never had a severe whipping from God. Amen, Father? I don't care. I mean, he gives money to every ungodly cause. The Jesus freaks. My God. You know, Red Buckley, and everything's all right. I want to say to Mary that his influence is quickly withering away. Now, thank God. 1954 or 5, my mother took me out some say, by 54, I guess, 53. My mother took me out there to hear him preach. 75,000 people in a big stadium, all Baptists. Just a few months ago in Houston, Texas, with every Seventh-day Adventist, Catholic, Jehovah, everybody you could imagine, I mean every kind, creed, color, whatever, and there they had 20,000 people. And so the people walked down the aisle, and when they walked down the aisle, they said, "Well, what are you? I'm a Catholic, I come, I want to be born." "Yes, sir, and Father so-and-so will deal with you." And just sort of looked like Zorro, had one in Frankenstein colors on, you know. Everybody called him Father. He knelt down and blessed them and blessed them and blessed them. And they wrote him down and said, "We had another convert." Uh-huh. You poor idiot, you. You can't take it, can you? You're a hellfire and brimstone preacher. You little sissy, you. You little sissy, you. You say, "Brother Wood, I just believe that anybody that just died and calls on the Lord, he's saved." You've got to be, oh, you need to be over here in a hospital somewhere. You need to have a straitjacket. There's something wrong with you. Listen, his influence, there used to be 60,000. Now, there's only 20,000. Used to be meetings constantly, all the time. Now, it's down to 3 meetings a year. Yes, sir. Thank God he's right. He's deceived many weak believers. Some of you weak as Branchwater tonight. And you said, "Boy, Brother Wood, look at the crowd that's following. Look at the crowd that's following Stallback. Look at the crowd that's following the Cowboys. Huh? Look at the crowd that's following Adolf Hitler and Mussolini. Look at the crowd that's following Khrushchev. Just because a crowd, that don't mean a Christ. A crowd does not mean a Christ." And I want to say there's been many, a little weak believer. I mean, a young preacher have followed this man into an ecumenical faith. When in the world did a Baptist who loved God and lived a separated life, how could he have a meeting with a Presbyterian who don't even know Jesus Christ, taught in the seminary to deny the virgin birth, and those men come together, get on the platform, call him to lead in prayer? My soul. This thing, and you know, we come out of this thing, and we quit preaching about this thing. We just forgot this for years. And all of a sudden, we dressed it up in another color. We headed right back, boys. Listen, old Dr. J. Frank Norris, that great man of God, and here just the other day, a group of them, they had a Catholic woman, they had the Independent Baptist, they had the Southern Baptist, and 2 men from the World Baptist went over and preached. And now that woman, sick, who don't even believe nothing about the Bible, she's a Roman Catholic. And thank God for this. Curtis Hudson wrote him a letter. He was booked to be on the meeting. He said, "I'm just sorry. I'm sorry. I just can't come. I cannot preach. I thank God for Curtis and his stand." And he said, "I will not come and preach with that lady." And in the Houston paper, James Robinson put it, "I've known him. I knew his man who raised him, his stepdad who raised him. I knew not his stepdad, but an old preacher raised the boy. Old Brother Hale raised him at the Second Baptist Church in Pasadena." And he put in the paper, he said, these red-faced fundamentalists wouldn't be in our meeting. That's me. That's me. I mean, why me with a big B and a big F? I'm a Baptist fundamentalist. And I ain't going to be in his meeting with a Roman Catholic woman up there preaching. Because women ain't supposed to be preaching nowhere. And this wasn't in a mild majority group. This was in a Bible conference. Yes, sir. I believe this thing needs to be dealt with here tonight, Carl. And I wish old Sam Woods had come down that dynamite I was telling you about. I believe we need to blow a stump or two here. Amen. But he deceived many. And then young believers were led into godless churches. You said, Brother Ridge, you believe some of those people got saved? How many of y'all were saved in the Billy Graham Crusade? Raise your hand. There's one right there. God bless you. Amen. There's one man got saved there. You're the second one I've ever met. And it's good to meet you. Yes, sir. I've never met a man. I've only been on the road 29 years. I've never met a man called a preacher in a Billy Graham Crusade. I saw some in the car like him. Saw about three or four in the Jack Woods. A few under this man and that man. A few under Peter Redman. But there's a funny thing. I've never found nobody under this man. But I want to say this now and go right over the message. He not only does that, he's corrupted schools of theology. You said, give me the incident, Brother Wood. Give me his name, John. When Dr. in Minneapolis, Minnesota, Pastor First Baptist Church. Well, Dr. Riley, there you go. Dr. W.B. Riley, he died. They give Billy Graham that school. They give him that school, and that school went down the tube. And Dr. Riley took it out of the convention. In 5 years' time, he was back in the convention. The Northern Baptist Convention that denies the virgin birth of Christ. You know, I believe tonight we're sitting in fundamentalist camp, and I believe we're just fixing a slide past. And I believe every one of them are going back to Rome. Because when you mention the leaders that are leading us to Rome, it makes Baptists mad. Yeah. They don't like it. They say, you just leave us alone. And bless God, if we want to worship God with the Pope, that's our business. You go ahead and worship God with the Pope, honey, but I'm going to be in the rapture, and you and the Pope can have yourself a time. Yeah. That's right. He condones. And these weak believers, and these schools of theology went down the drain. And he, when I was at Tennessee Temple in 1954, I guess it was, or 55, I was at school. George Douglas Shea was in town. Oh, they're lovely Christian men. They say we're red-faced, we're ugly, we're cantankerous, we're mean. And we called him and asked him if he'd come and sing in the chapel. He said, what's the name of the school? Tennessee Temple. Well, no, I couldn't do that. I couldn't. But you know where he was singing the next day? Over at the Presbyterian school. But you know what we are? We're ugly. And we're mean. And we're hateful. And we're really just, it's infinite bad, we're just really ungodly. Because, see, you're not supposed to say anything mean about anybody. In other words, you ought to just say the devil's a pretty nice guy, you know. At least he stays busy, you know. That's right. But I want to say this. He condones wickedness. Is Billy Graham saved? Brother Wood says, no, you can say what you want to. If I see him in heaven, I'll be the most surprised person in the world. And if Norman Vincent Peale and Mr. Fosdick and Mr. Niebuhr is there with him, I'm going to leave that pick. I know I'm in the wrong place. This thing might not even be as serious to you. It might not even be as serious to you. But I'm here to tell you tonight that every man that's sitting in this building tonight, or every woman who lost a brother, who lost a part of your family in World War II, Niebuhr, Fosdick, and a bunch of modernists are responsible for every drop of blood on the foreign field. In 1934, 1935, Douglas MacArthur told him, said the Japanese were coming in to invade these islands, and Niebuhr and Fosdick and all them modernists said, stood right there in Washington, told Mr. Roosevelt, and said, listen, we don't need to buy guns, because we're pacifists. And a pacifist and a modernist and a communist all cut out the same piece of cloth. Yes. So they said, every man died on Wake Island, you take his blood and lay it at the door. And when that war was over in this meeting, I'll tell you, about 1947, Dr. Carroll, who was a leading modernist, he said, I stand before this ecumenical movement here today in 1949. Dr. Bob Jones Sr. was there. I heard him. Dr. Carroll said, the blood of every man that died in this great war is dripping from the hands of us modernists. And we shall return back to our
orthodoxy that we've left many years ago. Shall we go all the way? No! 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 What we shall do is find us a new modernism. And I'm here to tell you today, they found it. It's called neo-evangelicalism. Yes, sir. A modernist is the enemy of your church. He's the enemy of your country. And World War II proved that. They stood in the streets faster than Niebuhr. They stood in those streets. They were ahead of Union Theological Seminary, and it's the most communistic, wicked, godless fool the world has ever known. Everybody knows that. Dr. Graham went there and said, I want to tell you today, the gospel that I preach has got a loaf of bread in one hand and a gospel in another. I tell you, the gospel that I preach is the blood in God's hand to save you and nothing else. I have no social gospel for a lost and dying world. Thank you, Brother Wood, but he condones wickedness. Come back down another day. Second Baptist Church had one of his preachers and invited the whole town to come over to Second Baptist Church and hear this dear lady preach. She's now on the Billy Graham. Her name is McClain. A wonderful preacher from the state of North Carolina. First volunteers, will you? Okay, thank you. I won't say that. At least a bunch of stupid idiots out there just let her do it. He condones women preachers, modernists, the movie stars. Oh, he's a fundamentalist, sure. Godless men like Peel, versions of every different word of God there is. Don't get mad at me. I didn't do none of that. I didn't do that. I didn't let that woman preach in the pulpit. Don't get mad at me. I didn't say Jesus got drunk. I mean, don't get mad at me. How come y'all so mad? Some of you hellfire and brimstone preachers. God bless you. Ain't you sad? Ain't you, don't you wish you were somewhere else tonight? Don't you wish you said, well, what I do? Well, I tell you what we'll do. We'll take one, we'll have a 5 minute, a 5 second interval, and we'll bow our heads. But you, sissy, you sneak out. Amen. That's right. He condones wickedness. He's an enemy of every true worshiper. Jack Wilson, 1953, invited Billy Graham to New York to hold a revival meeting. He said, y'all get together. I said, I've been invited by the other group, which were a bunch of modernists from the Union Theological Seminary. And so he come down and met with him, and Jack Wilson said, okay. He said, he argued with him, said, let's have a doctrinal stand. He said, I have no doctrinal stand. And I am of the persuasion, Brother Jones, that the church, when she leaves here, her apparel is not going to be holiness. Her apparel, her clothing, is going to be doctrine. The church has always been identified by doctrine. The church has always been clothed in Bible doctrine. And there's a little thing going on today, you hear it too, don't you? Well, these new evangelicals said it don't make any difference what you believe. You know, just put your doctrine aside. Well, I mean, you know, doctrine aside, that should put your teaching aside. Put the Word of God aside. How can you put the Word of God aside? And so these men here are enemies of the true worshiper. They call us red-faced fundamentalists. I guess we are. I say amen to that. That's right. I say amen to that. But they call us what they please. But if we say anything about it, they said, you know, Brother Wood don't have any love. And you know, the issue today is meeting us men who believe the King James Bible. They said, why don't we just forget these issues and go on about soul winning? Brother Carl, how many, you say y'all had saved here the last month? About how many, more or less? About 50. Brother Carl, what you need to do is quit these issues and go to soul winning. I'd like to ask you a question. Dr. Graham had that great meeting in New York. I wonder how many souls have been saved in the First Methodist Church since he held that meeting. How many souls do you think were saved in St. Teresa's Catholic Church since he left Houston? How many souls do you think were saved in Reagan's good buddy up there? What's his name, Bush? Is that the guy's name? Is that the last president? What's his name? Bush. He's my friend Jackson. He's Bush, all right. His pastor said the other day,
He was one of Billy Graham crusade. He said, "Brother Bush, I want you to know, everybody knows, that Mr. Bush and me have never been burned again." And put it in the Houston paper where everybody could read on the religious side and said, "We are well pleased with our first birth, and our family were of good heritage, and we are fine people, and we're satisfied with our first birth. We don't need a new birth." When Mr. Bush gets to hell, he'll wish he had something. And I'm going to tell you one thing, he's going to look over that fire and trust Billy Graham while he's doing it. Well, I tell you. Oh, Lord. You know, an old drunkard. Yes, he's all bush on it. But an old drunkard walks down the aisle here. Old drunkard comes down the aisle, makes a profession of faith, and you see him about 3 weeks later, and he's drunk. And he's just a drinking and a drinking. Brother Carter, you kind of get the idea that maybe he didn't get saved. That's about right there. Well, you know, if a man who went into a modern religion, false as it can be, led everybody astray and stayed that 25 years, wouldn't you kind of get the idea that maybe, like you told Dr. Parker, "I thought I got saved under Mordecai Ham, I thought I got saved under you, and I thought I got saved." It really doesn't make a difference where you got saved. But I was out in West Texas preaching here a while back, and I asked a man, I said, "Where'd you get saved?" He said, "Walked outside," and he walked right back to the second seat, and he said, "I said, right there." He said, "49 years ago, I said, right there," and he said, "Down on my knees, I called on God," and he said, "God came and met with me there." He said, "I'm just an old country boy, very wood cowboy, and I tried to preach across these hills, but I know where I got saved." This man don't know where he got saved, and I don't know where he got saved. And he doesn't live like he's saved. And he don't talk like a saved man. What's up now? Now, he's the enemy of them true worshipers are uncooperating. Now, I have a... Don Green was sitting with us yesterday. Don and I have just become close friends and call each other every week on the phone. I call Brother Kyle and... Us three maybe have personalities alive or something, I don't know. But anyway, we was all sitting there yesterday, and you was there, and Don jumped up from the table, and we was eating, and his boy was sitting about, 8 or 10 of us there? And he got up and raised his hand, hollered glory to God, and he ran around the cafe, and he said, "Glory to God." Tears started running down his face. That old mean preacher, y'all think he's mean. Tears running down his face. He said, "Glory to God." He said, 8 years ago, I made a decision to leave the group I was with because of the Bible. And God let me sit down here today with God's men. And my boy is the greatest of the influence of God's men. He said, "I just want to praise God for the decision. Glory to God. Glory to God. I'm glad. I'm glad, Dave." That's my boy sitting over there. "I'm glad, Dave. I'm glad we didn't have nothing. We lived in a little old shack, Dave. We didn't have nothing. We cleaned the septic tank out with a bucket. I mean, just cleaned out. Just Leopold. I mean, just run a boy rolling right through the side of the house. Never knock a hair off her. I mean, just poor. Very poor." Then Evangelist laughed at me. Freddie Gage, he said, "Jack, you're going to wind up with one black suit teaching the Bible for Brother Willow." They laughed. But you know now they're talking about what they used to be. What they used to be. And ain't never been nothing. They're just a, you know, that sensationalism is gone. You can read that book, Pulpit in the Shadows. We're uncorporated. We're unchristlike. We're peddlers of hate. They said, "Erect face on a minute." That don't sound like a very good Christian word to use on a man.
How about that? Yeah. Yeah, that's
right. Why don't you say them bare-faced, dirty, wicked, ungodly modernists?
Yeah. Yeah.
Why don't you say them nasty, dirty, filthy communists?
Yeah.
Why do you pour your hate out on the church of God? In the sky, we love everybody. May the Lord bless you. Dr. Billy Graham does not recognize the work of God.
That's right.
Youth for Christ is not the work of God.
That's right.
The work of God is a local, independent church. That's the work of God. And the church has no say in what he does.
So modernist is what he does.
And I'm telling you tonight that the fundamentalists are headed that way and the ecumenicalists. We're headed that way. Listen, he gives his money to the Youth for Christ. Last year, he said, I gave $250,000 to the Youth for Christ. You ought to see them witnessing. They got their hair all down over their ears. They got their tight fitting bitches on. The little girl's got a pair of Bermuda shorts on. And she's sitting down teaching the Bible. Said, wouldn't you like to be saved? Right. God bless you. They go over in them foreign countries. I got a letter from that team, mission board. I got it. And three ladies was over there winning this girl to Christ. One of them had a pair of Bermuda shorts on. The other had a pair of tight fitting bitches on. And they're just leading people to Jesus. And Lord, help us. Hallelujah. In this good car?
Yeah.
Well, we're in a King James Jubilee.
Yeah.
And some of y'all ain't having the Jubilee, are you? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You know, I'd like tonight to call Dr. Bob Jones Jr. Sir Bob Jones Jr. How much money has Billy Graham donated to y'all? I hear him say, is this a practical joke? Hang up. I'd like to call Dr. Lee Robinson tonight and say, Dr. Robinson, how much money has he donated? Any of you little independent Baptist churches struggling, trying to get by, they ever helped you? No. They helped Youth for Christ. You know why? Because in Houston, Texas, the other day, they sat down in a room and they said, lock the doors. And they locked the doors and a bunch of rich men, and it was in the Houston paper on the headlines, and they took up $7 million that night for Youth for Christ, and they wrote a church after cash. Anything to help the Youth for Christ. Most wicked, ungodly, unchurched organization there is. Thank you, Brother Wood. They do not recognize the Church of God. They come to Houston, nobody has ever come and said, Brother Wood, would you even like to participate in our campaign? Why do they call me a red fundamentalist? They ain't never even heard me. But I want to thank God for the Presbyterian. They got more conviction than y'all have. I see that now. Some of y'all ain't got none. But there was that the other day, and they walked up and said, Dr. Graham is a friend, a real friend, he said, real friend. And on the back of it said, to the communists. The Presbyterians were laughing. Said, he's a real friend, real friend. And while he was having a service all day over in Russia, a lady got up and said, we've got 250 in Siberia. And they drug her out to ship her to Siberia. And he got up and he said, what do you think about that? And he said, well, if you violate the law in America, they'll put you in jail. Yeah. He's a scum. But a fluid drive.
Yeah.
I told my boy the other day, he said, Dad, honey, he said, you want me to shoot that skunk here? I said, mm-mm. Leave that skunk alone. Well, you come to shout her out, didn't you?
Yeah.
You get right with God, you will shout her out. Amen. He does not recognize the local church. He does not attend the local. I want to ask you a question. How big a shot do you have to be till you get immune to the local church? Call this pastor tonight, Dr. Christmas. Stand on this pulpit, Dr. Christmas, and tell us the last time he's been to church. Oh, Brother Wood, he's so busy. Busy doing what? Full three meetings a year. What's he busy doing? He's going to hell for what he's done. John, you've been married to Carol for many years. You've been an old salt. You've been that Navy. Man, put his hand on that woman, John. You hurt him. All right. That's right. You've been married to that woman. She's been through hell, jails, and what have you. Sure. What about the Lord Jesus and his little church? And this bunch of wicked devils. Right. Get up, this bunch of moderns. And stand up and say, "Fast the church. Norman and Vincent Peale. Fast it. For cracking. And that crowd. My soul, what's where we at? 1951 in Los Angeles, California. Dr. Graham got up and preached on the stage. Comes to our close now. You've had enough. He got up and preached and he said, I want to preach to you on a second coming of Christ. And I want to tell you that one of the greatest theologians of our time said, Dr. W.B. Riley, the next great event on the history pages is the second coming of Christ. 15 years later, preached the same sermon. Preached the same message, word for word. But he took Dr. W.B. Riley's name out there and put Dr. Butzman. Dr. Butzman is a modernist of the notorious type. He said, Dr. Butzman said, the next event on the page of history is the second coming of Christ. W.B. Riley meant that the Lord was coming for the church of God. Dr. Busman meant that the church was going to invest the world and socialize her and make her a better place to live. They meant two different things. They meant two different things. But you've been duped and listened and said, well, Brother Wood, he preaches the gospel. I heard him say this with my own 2 ears. He said, if you don't know you're a sinner, and you don't understand you're a sinner, the Bible says you're a sinner. Just believe that you're a sinner and come to Christ and make your decision. And when you do, you'll go to hell and cuss him through eternity. Every head bowed.